From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
I have given my blessing to Congress, and Congress is working with you and your representatives on coming up with a plan and a payment plan and how it's all going to be funded.
President Trump said his administration deserves a 10 out of 10 for its response to the ongoing humanitarian crisis in Puerto Rico. But over 1 million people on the island still lack clean drinking water. Residents say they're suffering eye infections and gastrointestinal diseases as a result of exposure to contaminated water. We'll get response from Puerto Rican environmental activist Elizabeth Yompierre, who just co-wrote a piece with Naomi Klein headlined, Imagine a Puerto Rico Recovery. Designed by Puerto Ricans. Then we look at the U.S. military presence in Africa. What happened during the ambush of U.S. special forces by militants in Niger, in which 5 Nigerian soldiers were killed, along with 4 U.S. Green Berets?
First and foremost, in this particular case, we owe the families as much information as we can find out about what happened. And we owe the American people an explanation of what their men and women were doing at this particular time.
We'll speak with attorney Mark Fancher. His new piece, U.S. Troop Deaths in Niger, AFRICOM's Chickens Come Home to Roost. And we'll speak with Professor Horace Campbell, now at the Institute of African Studies at the University of Ghana. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Joint Chiefs of Staff Chair General Joseph Dunford Monday laid out a timeline of the deadly October 4th ambush, in which 5 soldiers from Niger and 4 U.S. troops were killed while on parole, promising the military would conduct a—were on patrol, promising the military would conduct a thorough and transparent investigation. The general's explanation came as the widow of U.S. Army Sergeant LaDavid Johnson spoke out against Donald Trump's handling of the aftermath of the attack, saying during a condolence call the president couldn't remember the name of her husband. In an interview with ABC's Good Morning America Monday, Maisha Johnson reaffirmed she and others heard President Trump say, quote, he knew what he signed up for, but it hurts anyway, refuting President Trump's claim that the remark was totally fabricated.
It made me cry because I was very angry at the tone of his voice and how he said it. Like he couldn't remember my husband's name. The only way he remembered my husband's name because he told me he had my husband report in front of him. And that's when he actually said, LaDavid. I heard him stumbling on trying to remember my husband's name. And that would hurt me the most, because if my husband is out here fighting for our country and he risks his life for our country, why can't you remember his name?
Trump responded on Twitter, saying, I had a very respectful conversation with the widow of Sergeant LaDavid Johnson and spoke his name from beginning without hesitation. Maisha Johnson also said she wasn't allowed to view her husband's body and demanded answers about how he died during that patrol in Niger on October 4th. We'll have more on the Niger attack and the growing U.S. troop presence in Africa after headlines. U.S. Pentagon Chief Jim Mattis arrived in the Philippines Monday for an annual meeting of regional defense ministers as the Philippines government declared victory in its months-long battle to dislodge ISIS-allied militants in the city of Marawi. Human rights groups say the fighting displaced over 200,000 people and left more than 1,000 civilians dead. Over the summer, the Pentagon confirmed U.S. troops assisted the fight with training, aerial surveillance and electronic eavesdropping. Newly released video shows the minute agents with the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration opened fire on a boat in Honduras in 2012, killing 4 civilians, including 2 pregnant women. The video, obtained by ProPublica and The New York Times, appears to show the civilians did not open fire on DEA agents, as the agency had long claimed in public statements and in congressional testimony. The video's release followed a scathing report by the inspectors general of the Justice and State Departments, who say the DEA repeatedly lied about the incident. The agents were part of a now-shuttered task force known as the Foreign Deployed Advisory Support Team, or FAST, which was trained in military-style anti-drug raids. Republican Senator John McCain took an apparent swipe at President Trump over his multiple deferments from the draft during the Vietnam War, including a 1968 medical exam that declared Trump unfit to serve due to his bone spurs in his heels. Senator McCain was speaking in an appearance Monday on ABC's The View.
One of the great inequities of the Vietnam conflict was the lowest income Americans went and fought and were drafted. And those who were wealthy enough to have a doctor to say, hey, you got a bone spur or you got migraines or whatever it is, then they were excused.
McCain made a similar comment to C-SPAN over the weekend. He later insisted the bone spur references weren't directed at the president. In 2015, then-candidate Donald Trump said McCain was only considered a war hero because he was captured by the Vietnamese army, adding, I like people who weren't captured. The United Nations says international donors have pledged $434 million to aid more than 600,000 Rohingya refugees who fled to Bangladesh to escape ethnic cleansing in Burma. The pledges at a one-day donor conference came as refugee agencies warn more than 1,000 Rohingya continue to cross each day, fleeing rape, killings and the burning of their villages in Rakhine State. The pledges came as the Trump administration said it's withdrawing military assistance units from Burma and considering sanctions against Burmese officials believed to be behind violent traumatic abuses. In Moscow, a popular radio talk show host is in critical condition after a man burst into her Moscow radio station Monday and stabbed her in the throat. The editor-in-chief of the Echo of Moscow radio station says 32-year-old Tatiana Felgenhauer was not on the air at the time of the attack, which left the green room of the radio station splattered with blood.
With full understanding of where he was going, he came through here, entered the room, and stabbed Tatiana with a knife into the neck. That's what we know. It is a penetrating injury, lots of blood. But Tatiana left on her own legs to an ambulance downstairs.
Doctors say they've since placed Tatiana Felgenhauer on the ventilator and in an induced coma. The attacker was later arrested on charges of attempted murder. Russian state media claim the man was motivated by hooliganism and had a personal fixation on Felgenhauer. Reporters at the station say they've been the target of repeated death threats after offering airtime to dissidents, including opponents of President Vladimir Putin. In New York City, members of the Russian protest group Pussy Riot dropped a banner and scattered hundreds of leaflets inside Trump Tower Monday, shutting down access to the building for about half hour. The activist banner read, Free Sentsov, a reference to Ukrainian filmmaker Oleg Sentsov, who's currently serving a 20-year prison term in a Russian prison on terrorism charges. His supporters say he's innocent of any crime and was jailed over his criticism of Russia's annexation of Crimea. Amnesty International has called for his release. The Department of Education has revoked 72 policy documents detailing the rights of disabled students, calling them outdated, unnecessary, or ineffective. The documents spelled out ways schools should comply with two civil rights laws, the Rehabilitation Act and Disabilities Education Act. Among the documents rescinded was one offering guidance to schools on how to use federal funds for special education. A spokesperson for Education Secretary Betsy DeVos declined to comment on the changes during her confirmation hearings last January. DeVos told senators states should be left to decide whether to comply with the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. That prompted a follow-up question to DeVos by New Hampshire Democrat Maggie Hassan.
I want to go back to the Individual with Disabilities and Education Act. That's a federal civil rights law. So do you stand by your statement a few minutes ago that it should be up to the states whether to follow it?
The law must be federal law must be followed where federal dollars are in play.
So were you unaware what I just asked you about the IDEA, that it was a federal law?
I may have confused it.
New York's attorney general has opened a civil rights probe into the Weinstein Company after dozens of women came forward alleging rape and other sexual crimes by movie mogul Harvey Weinstein. Schneiderman has subpoenaed company records relating to sexual harassment and gender discrimination complaints, investigating whether the company broke state civil rights law or New York City human rights law. The probe comes after a former assistant to company co-founder Bob Weinstein said she warned her boss 25 years ago about sexual misconduct of his brother, Harvey Weinstein. Bob Weinstein faces his own charges of sexual misconduct after producer Amanda Siegel told Variety magazine he made unwanted romantic overtures toward her while asking highly intimate questions during a production in June of 2016. NBC morning show host Megyn Kelly blasted her former Fox News colleague Bill O'Reilly Monday, saying she complained about O'Reilly's sexual harassment of women at the network, but was repeatedly ignored.
O'Reilly's suggestion that no one ever complained about his behavior is false. I know because I complained. Women everywhere are used to being dismissed, ignored, or attacked when raising complaints about men in authority positions. They stay silent so often out of fear. Fear of ending their careers, fear of lawyers, yes. And often fear of public shaming.
Kelly made the remarks after O'Reilly denied he'd committed sexual misconduct, telling radio host Glenn Beck he was the victim of a smear campaign by the New York Times. On Saturday, the Times reported O'Reilly reached a $32 million settlement with a former Fox News presenter to settle sexual harassment claims just weeks before Fox News signed him to a $25 million a year contract. It was at least the sixth such settlement during O'Reilly's time at the network. In Montreal, Canada, protesters have begun riding the city's buses and trains wearing traditional Islamic face veils known as niqabs, as well as scarves and other coverings, in solidarity with Muslim women and in defiance of a new law requiring people to show their faces when receiving public services. Protesters say Quebec Bill 62 is an Islamophobic law aimed at stigmatizing the province's Muslim minority.
Throughout the whole bus ride, I have to uncover my face. Like, what is the reason behind it? What did I do? What crime did I commit that I have my fundamental rights violated?
Even if you believe that the niqab is oppressive in some way and that women are struggling with this, if that really is a problem, cutting them out of public transit and access to education and medical care is simply not the solution.
Supporters of the bill point to similar laws passed in France and say it's aimed at upholding Quebec's secular traditions. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, who campaigned in 2015 against former Premier Stephen Harper's Islamophobic rhetoric, offered muted criticism of Quebec's niqab ban and said it's not up to the federal government to challenge the law. In the Gulf of Mexico, officials with the LLOG Exploration Company say a rupture in a pipeline south of Louisiana this month led to the Gulf's largest oil spill since the 2010 Deepwater Horizon disaster. The spill dumped an estimated 672,000 gallons of oil into 1 mile deep water about 40 miles off the coast. Meanwhile, the Coast Guard has called off a search for two workers who went missing Friday after their oil barge exploded in waters off the coast of Port Aransas, Texas. The barge was carrying 133,000 barrels of crude oil, some of which spilled into the Gulf. Nicaragua says it'll join the Paris Climate Accord, leaving Donald Trump and Syrian President Bashar al-Assad as the only world leaders rejecting the landmark 2015 agreement. Nicaragua had been a holdout, arguing for more dramatic action needed to prevent catastrophic climate change. But the country's vice president said Monday the deal is the only instrument the world has to tackle global warming. President Trump announced in June he would withdraw the U.S. from the Paris Accord, prompting condemnation from climate activists and heads of state in every corner of the globe. Meanwhile, a new report from the Government Accountability Office finds climate change is already costing U.S. taxpayers billions of dollars per year, with costs expected to skyrocket over the coming years. The GAO report found taxpayers paid out more than $350 billion over the last decade on flood and crop insurance, along with disaster assistance programs. That figure is before factoring in the massive costs of this year's three major hurricanes and devastating wildfires in western states. And activists rallied in dozens of cities across the U.S. and worldwide under the hashtag #DivestTheGlobe Monday, calling on people to pull their funds from banks that invest in the fossil fuel economy. In Oakland, California, indigenous women led a march to branches of Wells Fargo, Chase and Citibank, urging patrons to close their accounts. In Seattle, police arrested seven activists as they nonviolently shut down major bank branches over their financing of the Dakota Access and Keystone XL pipelines. This is Rachel Heaton, a leader of the Muckleshoot tribe, speaking outside a Bank of America branch.
We are not just affected here in the United States. These banks are causing problems all over the world. They're privatizing water. They're causing deforestation. There's pollution. And so today, we are divesting the globe. And here in Seattle, we are shutting down. We are visiting over 100 banks today.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show in Puerto Rico, where 3.5 million residents and half the island's hospitals still have no electricity from the power grid more than a month after Hurricane Maria. Over 1 million people still lack clean drinking water, and residents say they are suffering from eye infections and gastrointestinal diseases as a result of exposure to contaminated water. More than a third of the island's sewage treatment plants are not functioning, and some 40% of residents lack a cell phone signal. Meanwhile, the Environmental Protection Agency has not yet inspected 5 out of 18 of Puerto Rico's toxic waste sites, also known as Superfund sites. The official death toll now stands at 49, with health experts saying the real number is likely to rise.
On Monday, FEMA announced more than $500 million in aid to the island, including $285 million to help restore electricity and water services. The Senate also tentatively approved a $36.5 billion hurricane relief package that includes aid for Puerto Rico. A final vote is expected later today before the measure heads to President Trump. But first, Republican Senators Jeff Flake of Arizona and Mike Lee of Utah are demanding Puerto Rico be made permanently exempt from the Jones Act, a 1920 law that has complicated efforts to send supplies to the hurricane-ravaged island. All of this comes as President Trump said on Thursday, his administration deserves a 10 out of 10 for its response to the ongoing humanitarian crisis in Puerto Rico.
I think we've done a really great job, and we've had tremendous cooperation from the governor, and we are getting there. And people are really seeing the effort that's been put into Puerto Rico. It's been a very, very difficult situation for many people, I will say that. It hit right through the middle of the island, right through the middle of Puerto Rico. There's never been anything like that. I give ourselves a 10.
Puerto Rico is saddled with a $74 billion debt and now faces an estimated $95 billion in storm-related damage. Many are now questioning what the recovery effort will look like. Who will benefit? Who will be left out? In a new piece for The Intercept, Puerto Rican activist Elizabeth Yompierre and Naomi Klein write, "Imagine a Puerto Rico recovery designed by Puerto Ricans." They write, "The fact that the House-approved relief package contains $5 billion in loans for the island, rather than grants, is a special kind of cruelty. Because on an island already suffering under an unpayable $74 billion debt and another $49 billion in unfunded pension obligations, Puerto Ricans understand all too well that debt is not relief. On the contrary, it's a potent tool of perpetual impoverishment and control from which relief is urgently needed." The authors also look at how communities in Puerto Rico are now working together to achieve a more just recovery. For more, we go to Elizabeth Yompierre. She's joining us from Berkeley, California, executive director of UpRose and co-chair of the Climate Justice Alliance. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Elizabeth. First, describe what's happening on the ground in Puerto Rico, what you are most struck by and what needs to happen.
Well, thank you for having me on the show and for keeping a spotlight on the island. We're in touch with activists on the island on a regular basis, people from Organización Boricua, a number of organizations that are really part of the frontline leadership working on climate justice issues. The first thing you hear about is that there's tons of food and water that they don't have access to, that they can't make it through the island because there's no gasoline, that that there's also a state of militarization in Puerto Rico, that there are police officers coming in from almost every state in the country, and the military, and that people feel like they're being shut down, that they can't move around. People on the island are also working really closely together, cooking together, sharing resources, cleaning up, doing the work that's necessary so that they can get their lives back. But it feels like a police state. Artists are also working. Folks that are involved or were involved in food justice issues are also working hard to try to clean up some of the areas so that they can start growing things again. There's an enormous amount that folks on the ground are doing, and it's actually just a model of resistance and resilience from the people on the island.
Elizabeth, I wanted to ask you in terms of the hindrance to the recovery efforts. We've raised here on the show numerous times the situation with the Jones Act that creates enormous restrictions in terms of how supplies come into the island, how any kind of imports come into the island. But there's been quite a bit of a fight back from the AFL-CIO, which actually issued a statement several days ago. And I just want to read to you that statement from the AFL-CIO. They say, since the Jones Act ensures that our labor laws protect maritime employees, repealing the act would pave the way for foreign companies to replace domestic crews with lower-paid workers lacking basic labor protections. And they go on to say that that foreign flag ships often do not enforce safety standards, minimum social standards, or trade union rights, and they fail to pay crews and avoid compliance with environmental standards. They go on to say the Jones Act has in no way impeded Puerto Rico's recovery, and they say that the biggest problem has actually been lack of truck drivers and getting supplies from the ports to the island, not necessarily shipments coming in. I'm wondering your response to these statements by the AFL-CIO.
Sure. And, you know, sadly, that really sort of illustrates some of the conflicts that we have as part of the climate justice movement and labor. And they're sad conflicts because we support workers' rights and their environmental rights, their wages. All of that is really important to us. But the truth is that the Jones Act not only is delaying support for Puerto Rico, but it's also been responsible for the high cost of living because of the exorbitant costs of shipping goods to Puerto Rico. The truth is that in other nations and in other places, communities get resources from a lot of different nations and that those things get worked out. Just this past week, we worked really hard to get Greenpeace to provide their ship so that we could put all of the materials that people on the island had asked us for and transport those things on the vessel to Puerto Rico. But the ship that is owned by Greenpeace is an international vessel, and we did research that showed that not only the Jones Act prevents us from actually putting those goods on the ship, but that they can't actually deliver those goods to Puerto Rico. So it feels as if the United States is saying, we can't help you, we won't help you, and we're not going to let anyone else help you. Labor, I'm just really stunned that the families and the people who work for the unions are the same people that are going to be impacted by climate change, and that they really are only thinking about their economic interests and not thinking about a future that's already here. We had the same problem with the AFL-CIO when we organized for the People's Climate March, and they didn't want us to say, keep it in the ground. And when we're talking about literally a just transition, moving away from an extractive economy to one that's regenerative and providing jobs, and this is happening all over the world. So it's sort of a dated way of thinking about economic development, and it's also really something that makes you feel insensitive about the needs of unions, because we want to be able to be aligned with them. We care about their rights, and we care about their future, and we care about unions. But it's hard to do when they don't care about the survival of our community, when the needs of the shipping industry are more important than the lives of the people in Puerto Rico.
Elizabeth Jean-Pierre, can you, you're a longtime environmentalist as co-chair of the Climate Justice Alliance. Can you talk about the connections between climate change and Hurricane Maria? I mean, that's what happened in Puerto Rico. Interestingly, you're in San Francisco right now, and just north of you, of course, you've got this urban conflagration that has consumed parts of Napa. Santa Rosa is a wasteland in many parts. Can you talk about this issue of climate change and what isn't being talked about, even in the media that's covering the climate catastrophes, not mentioning that word, global warming?
Yeah, it's amazing, Amy. You know, I'm Puerto Rican. I run an organization that was founded by Puerto Ricans 50 years ago, and I'm a climate justice activist, and it feels like my worlds have collided. You know, the situation in Puerto Rico is a model of extraction. For generations, the United States has basically extracted our land, our labor, and Puerto Rico has now become sort of the poster child for climate injustice. And I refer to the 55,000 people have already left Puerto Rico in 33 days. And I think of them as climate refugees. Hurricane Maria came on the heels of Irma, on the heels of Harvey in Houston. We're right here in the Bay where there are all these wildfires. And I'm actually here in a meeting with It Takes Roots, which is made up of the Grassroots Global Justice Alliance, the Climate Justice Alliance, the Indigenous Environmental Network, Right to the City. All of us really grappling on how do you build transitions in communities that are faced with a crisis that's already here. So Puerto Rico is really a front line. And because its unique relationship with the United States, it makes it particularly vulnerable. Because other places, you know, if we're talking about Houston and exposure to toxics and toxicants, that was something that we saw coming years ago. You mentioned that I've been doing this for a while, and it's true. I was the chair of the U.S. EPA National Environmental Justice Advisory Council. And many years ago, I was talking about what do we do about industrial waterfront communities in the event of an extreme weather event? Is the EPA ready to address that issue? If we have an extreme weather event, Superfunds then basically overflow. Chemical exposure will cause disease for generations. What are we doing about that? And at the time, and it was under the Obama administration, the NEJAC didn't want to address climate change. They just wanted to talk about environmental justice in the traditional sense. And then New York City was hit by Sandy, and we were allowed to create a working group to address that. So we were able to do a study that kind of sat there and with recommendations from people from industrial waterfront communities. And the study just sat there collecting dust. And then Harvey happened. And Houston then becomes the exact thing that we were predicting. And then here in Puerto Rico, we've got 23 superfunds that have now flooded and affected everything so that even as people make their way through their communities to try to clean up, they're being exposed to any number of chemicals. No one is looking at the EJ executive order that really sort of says, you know, you've got to have an interagency approach to addressing these issues. What's the quality of the air? What's the quality of the water? What is the quality of the soil? Are people protected? Are they wearing protective gear? What's the exposure again to toxics and toxicants? So all of that is happening in Puerto Rico, in a tiny island that was just literally like just slaughtered by this hurricane. So we knew that this was coming. Of course, we were never prepared for it. But Puerto Rico really is that, sadly, that poster child of climate change. And so folks can deny that it's here, but honestly. You know, our scientists are telling us, 99% of the scientists are telling us that it's global warming.
Elizabeth?
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you to, if we can switch gears a little bit about the response of both the federal government and the Puerto Rico government itself to the subsequent to the disaster. We have the news now that the Senate is getting ready to move forward a bill, which is a $36 billion for all three, for Texas, Florida, and Puerto Rico, and of course, this issue of the loans to Puerto Rico instead of actual grants, and that FEMA is releasing $500 million immediately. But of course, FEMA is doing that because the PROMESA board installed by Congress sent a letter to the president and to the congressional leaders just about 10 days ago saying the government of Puerto Rico will be completely out of money by the end of this month, by October 30th. There is no money left to be able to do any kind of work. So, one, the nature of the federal response, but also the nature of the response by the local Puerto Rican government itself, the governor, Ricardo Rosselló, which hasn't gotten a whole lot of attention. But the governor initially hired a company, completely unknown company, to restore electricity in Puerto Rico, a company by the name of Whitefish LLC out of Montana, that it turns out only had two employees and virtually no track record, and yet was being hired to bring back all the electricity to Puerto Rico. The only interesting thing about Whitefish is that it's a small town in Montana of 3,000 people, where the only the most prominent resident of Whitefish, Montana, is Ryan Zinke, the Secretary of the Interior. So I'm wondering your response to how the government of Puerto Rico is handling the aftermath, and also the federal government.
Well, Juan, both are concerning. The federal government is concerning because the commitment to Puerto Rico is so small. And the president has actually said that all of his support is behind Texas, but basically Puerto Rico is going to have to save itself. So that's concerning. The governor of Puerto Rico, as you know, PROMESA really devastated Puerto Rico, and now we're really concerned about what Naomi calls disaster capitalism. The truth is that we're hearing that there are conversations being had with the governor of Puerto Rico and with private investors to privatize entire communities in Puerto Rico, like Arecibo. That's why we're so concerned about the fact that there are 55,000 people have left. We're afraid that the same thing is going to happen to Puerto Rico as happened in New Orleans, where people never came back and their communities were gentrified. And in Puerto Rico, we're concerned that entire towns and communities will be privatized. We've also been watching with interest his reaction to what the president is saying is a great recovery. And so we've been wondering, is his reaction one that has to do with the fact that he's afraid to upset this president and not get any relief at all? Or does he really believe this? It is, we're demanding transparency. We want to find out who these relationships are with. We want to find out where the relief is happening, for example. Which are the communities that have been prioritized for relief? Where's the money being invested? Is that going to communities where there are U.S.-owned properties, or is that going to communities that have been most impacted? Because, as you know, even before the storm, a lot of the resources went into recreational developments and hotels and properties owned by the United States. So those are questions that we have. We are concerned about what the recovery is going to look like. And Puerto Rico can't have a recovery that takes it back to where it was or leaves it in a place that makes it completely, that makes Puerto Ricans completely dependent on the United States, which is why we've been talking about a just recovery. All of the efforts that we've been hearing about are very conventional, and this is a very, climate change is a very unconventional situation. So we have no trust in this governor, and we have less trust in this president to solve the problem that Puerto Rico has that really was created through, not just through the storm, but from generations of extraction. And so this situation that Puerto Rico is in is one that could have been predicted because PROMESA left Puerto Rico devastated, and the hurricane has basically knocked it to its knees.
You know, some people have speculated, Elizabeth Jean-Pierre, that maybe President Trump isn't as concerned about Puerto Rico because they don't vote for president. You don't get to vote for president on the island. What about the fact that so many people are now moving to the mainland? I mean, they are American citizens. How does it work? Can they vote then?
Well, I think that if Puerto Ricans move to the states, that they may be able to vote once they establish residency here in the United States. I don't know if the reason that the president doesn't care about Puerto Rico is because they can't vote for president. That's possible. I think that the reason is deeper than that. I think that there is a disregard for the lives of people of color. That there's a disregard for, you know, folks who come from the global South. And so Puerto Rico is more seen as an economic opportunity for private interests in the United States. And the people are just sort of the backdrop to that interest. So I think that citizenship is important, and folks having the right to vote, clearly that's important. But I think it's more complicated than that.
Right. I mean, if so many Puerto Ricans move to Florida, I mean, could it flip Florida and make it Democratic? Just a question.
Well, you know, I heard that that the reason that Florida voted for Obama during that election was that there were so many Puerto Ricans in Central Florida that they actually had or played a role in tipping the vote. I don't know if that's true, but that's what we've heard.
Well, Elizabeth Jean-Pierre, we want to thank you for being with us, Executive Director of UpRose, co-chair of the Climate Justice Alliance. We will link to your piece that you just wrote with Naomi Klein for The Intercept. That piece is called Imagine a Puerto Rico Recovery Designed by Puerto Ricans. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, what happened in Niger and what is U.S.-Africa policy? Stay with us. En la ciudad del swing, donde nunca se duerme, donde se une la noche y el día, donde se baila hasta que se amanece, donde se juega un buen domino, un buen motivo para la cardosa, un don toma a la pelota y de repente mete un honrón. Se fue la ola. Por eso me gusta Puerto Rom, porque Puerto Rom es donde más yo gozo, vacílalo. Cero suele ser un taxi, dígale usted para donde quiera. Y si prefiere la antología, de un artefacto del año 40 y una botella y te formó la fiesta. Con una lata te formó la orquesta, sin validar de mi protocolo. Son muy sencillos y un poquito locos. Por eso me gusta Puerto Rico, porque en Puerto Rico es donde más yo gozo. Vacílalo. Vacílalo. Montaigne is here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We turn now to the U.S. military presence in Africa and what happened during the ambush of U.S. Special Forces by militants in the West African nation of Niger, which is now the subject of a military and FBI investigation. During a press conference Monday, Marine General Joseph Dunford, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, laid out a timeline of the Niger attack on October 4th, in which five Nigerian soldiers were killed, along with four U.S. Green Berets, after their 12-member Army Special Forces unit accompanied 30 Nigerian forces on a reconnaissance mission to an area near the village of Tongo Tongo, about an hour north of the capital. They reportedly ended up spending the night there, and when they left the next morning to return to their base, they encountered about 50 enemy fighters. This is General Dunford.
So early on the morning of 3rd October, as I mentioned, U.S. forces accompanied that Nigerian unit on a reconnaissance mission to gather information. The assessment by our leaders on the ground at that time was that contact with the enemy was unlikely. Mid-morning on October 4th, the patrol began to take fire as they were returning to their operating base. Approximately 1 hour after taking fire, the team requested support. And within minutes, a remotely piloted aircraft arrived overhead. Within an hour, French Mirage jets arrived on station. And then later that afternoon, French attack helicopters arrived on station, and a Nigerian quick reaction force arrived in the area where our troops were in contact with the enemy. During a firefight, two U.S. soldiers were wounded and evacuated by French air to Niamey. And that was consistent with the casualty evacuation plan that was in place for this particular operation. Three U.S. soldiers who were killed in action were evacuated on the evening of 4 October, and at that time, Sergeant LaDavid Johnson was still missing. On the evening of 6 October, Sergeant Johnson's body was found and subsequently evacuated.
Dunford's description underscored how long the attack dragged on. He said when he realized the body of Sergeant LaDavid Johnson was missing, he made a call to Defense Secretary Jim Mattis and got immediate approval to bring the, quote, full weight of the U.S. government to bear in order to locate the missing soldier. Dunford defended the broader American mission in Niger, saying U.S. forces have been in the country intermittently for more than two decades. At least 800 U.S. service members are currently stationed in the country to support a French-led mission to defeat the Islamic State, al-Qaeda, and Boko Haram in West Africa.
This comes as Republican Senator John McCain, chair of the Armed Services Committee, threatened to issue a subpoena in order to speed up the release of details about the attack. On Monday, Johnson's widow spoke out on Good Morning America about her husband's death, saying she's upset about remarks President Trump made during a condolence call. Maisha Johnson reaffirmed she and others heard Trump say he knew what he signed up for, but it hurts anyway. She said it, quote, made me cry even worse, and noted the president also struggled to remember her husband's name.
It made me cry because I was very angry at the tone of his voice and how he said it. Like he couldn't remember my husband's name. The only way he remembered my husband's name because he told me he had my husband report in front of him. And that's when he actually said LaDavid. I heard him stumbling on trying to remember my husband's name. And that was hurting me the most, because if my husband is out here fighting for our country and he risked his life for our country, why can't you remember his name?
Last week, Florida Congressmember Frederica Wilson said she heard the call in which President Trump told Johnson's widow he, quote, knew what he signed up for, but when it happens, it hurts anyway. Over the weekend, Trump called Wilson wacky in a series of tweets without once mentioning LaDavid Johnson or offering condolences to his family. That was the day of the funeral. Meanwhile, Somalia continues to recover a massive bombing in Mogadishu that killed at least 358 people and wounded over 400 others at a roadside bomb exploded on Sunday, killing 11 people. The explosions come after the Trump administration stepped up a U.S. campaign against al-Shabaab in Somalia. In March, Trump declared Somalia a so-called zone of active hostilities, giving wide latitude to military leaders to launch airstrikes and ground assaults. In May, that led to the first U.S. combat death in Somalia since 1993, when Navy SEAL Officer Kyle Milliken was killed in an assault on an al-Shabaab radio station. In August, a raid by U.S. soldiers and Somali troops on a village outside Mogadishu left 10 civilians dead, including three children. For more, we're joined by two guests. In Detroit, Mark Fancher is with us, an attorney, frequent contributor to the Black Agenda Report. His latest article, U.S. Troop Deaths in Niger, AFRICOM's Chickens Come Home to Roost. Joining us via Democracy Now! Video stream from Luanda, Angola, is Horace Campbell, currently spending a year in West Africa as the Kwame Nkrumah Chair of the Institute of African Studies at the University of Ghana. He is a peace and justice scholar and professor of African-American studies and political science at Syracuse University. We want to welcome you both. Professor Campbell, let's begin with you. You're on the continent. You're in Africa. Can you respond to what has happened in Niger and put it in a larger context of U.S.-Africa policy right now?
Greetings from Luanda, and greetings to all the people who want peace. What is happening with the United States' presence in Africa is similar to the United States' presence in the United States itself. That is, the lives of African people do not matter. The United States of America is involved in a duplicitous war on terror in Africa, when on the streets of the United States of America, black people are being terrorized. At the same time, the United States is in a dubious alliance with France that wants to instigate ideas about terror in order to save capitalism in France. So this relationship between the United States and France in what is called fighting war and terror in the Sahel comes 6 years after the United States, France, and Britain went into Libya to destroy that country because that country wanted to create the basis for the unification of Africa and an African currency. Last year, President Obama said that going into Libya was the biggest mistake of his presidency. Later in October of 2016, the British Parliament had a report that said that going into Libya was based on lies. The only government that did not respond was the French government that mobilized those who are called Al-Qaeda to fight against Gaddafi. The same French government that mobilized the so-called Al-Qaeda forces in the Mali, in Niger, is mobilizing within the United Nations to get African Union, to get five countries in Africa, Mauritania, Mali, Chad, Burkina Faso, and Niger, to support France, to get the United Nations to send millions of dollars to in this so-called fight against terrorism. The challenge for us in the peace and justice movement is to oppose both the United States and France in this so-called war on terror. What the people of West Africa need is money for reconstruction, health, housing, employment, and changing the natural environment so that the millions of youth can get jobs. It makes no sense for the United States of America to be spending $100 million to build a base in Agadez, in Niger, where France has already a military base, and France is using the United Nations in this so-called multidimensional peacekeeping force in this so-called war on terror. What we need is for a massive campaign to get the truth about why these people are in Niger, Mali, and Chad, because there is no war and terror going on when they finance the so-called terrorists to overthrow the government of Libya.
Professor Campbell, if you could, you've talked about France and the United States and their role. Most Americans were not aware that there were this many troops, American troops, in Africa. But could you also contrast or compare the French role and the U.S. role to China's increasing role in Africa and the strategy that China is using as well?
Well, in the case of France and the United States of America, both cannot compete with China. In the case of Niger, Niger provides 75% of the electricity needs of France because it produces uranium. 7.5% of the world's production of uranium comes from a French company in Niger. In 2010, in 2008, 2010, China promised to invest billions of dollars in oil production in Niger. The president of Niger at the time, Mamadou Tandja, had accused France of financing those who were called terrorists. He was overthrown in a coup d'etat. Both the United States and France and other members of the European Union are opposed to the Chinese presence in Africa because we're in a country like Djibouti. The United States has 4,000 troops. China has spent $5 billion building a state-of-the-art port and has spent $10 billion building a railway from Djibouti to the capital city of Ethiopia in Addis Ababa. There is no possibility of the United States of America and Western Europe competing with China in Africa. Africans do not want this competition over their territory. What Africans want is a demilitarization of the continent and for the duplicitous role of France, the European Union, and the United States to end in this so-called war on terror. The African people want money for reconstruction so that in a country such as Somalia, every cent that is being used for fighting the war on terror could be spent in building schools, and then the police operation could be used against Al-Shabaab. We can only deal with terror when we demilitarize it and treat the extremists in Africa in isolating them from the communities of young people who are fed up with the alienation because there's unemployment and low standards of living for the African people.
Professor Campbell, we have to break, but we're going to come back to this discussion, and we'll be joined by Mark Fancher, and find out specifically in Niger about the U.S. building a drone base there. And how many drone bases are being built across Africa? Right now, the U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, Nikki Haley, is taking a trip to South Sudan, Ethiopia, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. Stay with us.
All we know, we may never meet again. Before you go, make this moment sweet again.
We Know by Abby Lincoln here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We continue to examine the U.S. military presence in Africa and what happened during the ambush of U.S. Special Forces by militants in the West African nation of Niger, which is now the subject of a military and FBI investigation. I want to bring into the discussion Mark Fancher, an attorney and frequent contributor to Black Agenda Report. His latest article is titled, U.S. Troop Deaths in Niger, AFRICOM's Chickens Come Home to Roost. We're also joined by from Luanda, Angola, by Horace Campbell, Institute of African Studies professor at the University of Ghana. Mark Fancher, the chickens come home to roost. Explain.
Well, the U.S. Africa Command is something that was created in or about 2007. At the time, it was clear from its design that it was intended as a way for the United States to use military methods to carry out its imperialist agenda in Africa without having to run the risk of suffering U.S. casualties. The idea was that U.S. military forces would be placed in strategic locations in Africa for the purpose of training, advising, and directing the armies of African countries, essentially to carry out missions for the United States. So it was a, you know, they could have their cake and eat it too, sort of a situation where they could engage certain hostile forces in combat and not have to worry about U.S. troops dying. It has not worked out that way. We have just seen within the past month the fact that there are U.S. troops that are at risk as a result of this. It was inevitable. Anytime that you introduce violence into a situation that requires the construction of infrastructure and attending to the needs of the poor, you're going to run into this kind of thing. So it was, in a very real sense, their chickens coming home to roost.
Mark
they did
Fancher,
not escape.
Can you talk about what the U.S. troops are doing right now in Niger? I'm surprised many, a number of senators, although apparently they've been briefed several times this year, that at least 800 U.S. soldiers are in Niger right now. Can you talk about why a drone base is being built? Can you talk about where Agadez is, what they're doing both in Niger and in other places in that region?
Well, it's not just Niger. What many people also don't know is that this level of military presence can be found in many countries throughout Africa, most of them, as a matter of fact. Since 2007, the United States has been expanding its reach and has been planting small groups of people in various different locations, not always with what would be regarded as military bases, but as embassy-based operation centers, where they carry out military training and different operations using African armies. So it's no different in Niger. And the use of drones is just an extension of the basic idea of carrying out reconnaissance missions and sometimes actual attacks without putting U.S. troops at risk. So this is very much par for the course. And I really think it's important to really understand what has happened in Africa over the last 10 years. In 2007, when AFRICOM was created, the presence of terrorists, to the extent that we see them now, there was nothing comparable. The presence, if any, was minimal. What was going on in Africa at the time was that you had organizations like the Movement to Emancipate the Niger Delta, or MEND, which had engaged in very militant kinds of attacks on U.S. oil installations, breaking up pipelines, kidnapping U.S. Oil company and Western oil company personnel, and issuing a threat in 2006 that they could not guarantee the safety of either the facilities of oil companies in and about Nigeria and in that region, or the people who were sent there to work on them. It was at that moment that the United States decided that it was going to set up this special command, which was unprecedented for Africa exclusively. You know, you also see what was happening during that period was what they branded as piracy off the coastal waters of Somalia. These were fishermen whose waters had been contaminated by people who had come in and had plundered and raided their fishing facilities, and had made them unable to engage in a livelihood. And in retaliation, they began to attack those boats and ships that were coming through those waterways, which was a major international shipping lane. So these twin concerns about access to the coastal region in Somalia, the oil that was being produced in the Niger Delta and the Gulf of Guinea, those were the primary drivers for the creation of AFRICOM. And the more that the U.S. military established a presence in that region and throughout Africa, the more terrorism tended to grow.
Well, Mark Fanshawe, I wanted to ask you about another key event in the history of Africa, or the recent history of Africa, which was the U.S. participation in the overthrow of Gaddafi and the situation in Libya. To what degree did the total destabilization of Libya and the—Libya is now, in essence, a failed state—have an impact on the growth of extremism and terrorist groups in other parts of Africa?
Oh, it had a huge impact. And if you look at the infamous emails of Hillary Clinton, which are available at the State Department's website, you see an email exchange where State Department personnel are talking very frankly about their conversations with Sarkozy about his interest in overthrowing Gaddafi because he wanted two things. One, he wanted to eliminate the threat of a Pan-African currency, gold-backed currency that Gaddafi wanted to establish because he was afraid that it would devalue the franc. And he also wanted access to Gaddafi and Libya's oil fields. That was the bottom line for why they went after Gaddafi in the way that they did. And in order to do it, AFRICOM stepped in and played a major role in recruiting local forces within Libya to attack Gaddafi. They chose to establish relationships with some of the worst elements in Libya. In fact, one of the groups that they established a relationship with was one which, by its very name, said that its mission was to eliminate black people from Libya. And so they gave guns, heavy artillery, to all kinds of people in Libya with the hope and expectation that they would carry out this overthrow of the Libyan government and assassinate Gaddafi. That played itself out, but those weapons were still there.
Professor Horace Campbell, we just have 30 seconds. Your final comment in talking about what's happened in this latest attack in Niger. Also, five Nigerians were killed, not to mention what happened in Somalia with over 358 dead.
I want to follow up on the point about what happened in Libya and why the progressive forces must continue to press for a United Nations investigation in what happened in Libya. I spelled all of this out in my book, Global NATO and the Catastrophic Failure in Libya. What is happening in Niger is a continuation of what happened in Libya. France is in deep crisis. France has taken over as Under Secretary of Peacekeeping Forces in the United Nations. France tried to put a resolution through the United Nations Security Council to get more money for France in Niger in Chad, in Mali.
Horace Campbell, we're going to have to leave it there, and Mark Fancher as well, but we'll do part two and post it online at democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.